Hi, can everybody hear me? Yes, I can hear me. Hello, welcome to the Santa Fe Institute's 2019 Stanislaw Ulam Memorial Lecture Series, Part 2. I'm Jennifer Dunn, the Vice President for Science at the Santa Fe Institute, where I'm also a professor. These back-to-back lectures are a part of our community lecture series, which we are proud to bring to you, the intellectually curious people of Santa Fe. And we also thank the Lensic and the Santa Fe Reporter for additional support. I also want to thank Professor Jessica Fleck, Caitlin McShay, and other SFI staff for their hard work organizing SFI's community lecture series. These annual invited lectures are dedicated to the memory of Stanislaw Ulam, the great Polish mathematician. Ulam came from Poland to the Institute for Advanced Study in 1935, later worked at Harvard and other universities, and joined the Los Alamos National Lab in its founding year. He was an intellectual force at LANL from 1944 until his death in 1984, the year of SFI's founding. And at that time, his wife, Françoise, donated his entire book collection to SFI, which became the foundation for our library. I'm very pleased to introduce Lauren Ancel Meyers. Lauren is the Cooley Professor of Integrative Biology and Statistics and Data Science at the University of Texas at Austin. She did her undergrad at Harvard in Mathematics and Philosophy and received a PhD in Biological Sciences at Stanford. However, more importantly, at least for us, she has a long-standing association with the Santa Fe Institute. As a graduate student, she attended the 1998 Complex Systems Summer School, and she received a Steinmetz Fellowship to come back to SFI in 1999 to pursue collaborative research. A couple of years later, she came to SFI as a postdoctoral fellow. Since moving from SFI to Austin, she has become a member of our external faculty, served on the SFI Science Board, lectured at the summer school where she was once a student, organized meetings, and trained a graduate student who became a postdoctoral fellow. And that's just a few of the dimensions of her deep engagement with SFI. Lauren was also my first office mate at SFI. We both started as postdocs in early 2001, which is an incredibly long time ago. And I'm really grateful that we got to share a physical and intellectual space. As you know from reading her bio, Lauren is highly productive and a highly recognized pioneer in the field of network epidemiology and the application of machine learning to improve outbreak detection, forecasting, and control. She is on the front lines of research to uncover the social and biological drivers of epidemics, as well as creating really important and useful tools to track and mitigate epidemics. Last night, Lauren introduced the field of network epidemiology in her talk on outbreak detection, prediction, and containment in human social networks. Tonight, just in time for flu season, she takes us to the frontiers of influenza forecasting. She will discuss how network models and a diverse ecosystem of health, social media, and molecular data are improving our ability to grapple with an ever-dynamic landscape of influenza at local to global scales. Please join me in welcoming Lauren Ancel Meyers.
Good evening. Welcome back, those of you who were here last night, and hello to those of you who I haven't talked to yet. As Jennifer said, I'm shifting gears from networks to influenza tonight. And I want to start by asking you all to imagine a world in which we just don't have to worry about influenza anymore. That would be a world in which everything I'm about to talk about will be totally irrelevant, and I'd be out there scouring for some other scientific pursuit. Well, we really are starting to imagine just that. This is, doesn't look like. Give me a moment. Looks like there's no slides up there. Let's see if I can. Okay, well, if you could see what was up on the screen, what you would see is this. This is an article that we published just yesterday in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, which is a report on the economic and human benefits of developing a universal flu vaccine. And long story short, NIH is trying to make this a reality. They just launched last year a large and ambitious initiative to develop a universal flu vaccine that would protect people against all strains of the flu virus, past, present, and future. And there are already 40 different candidate vaccines under development that use all different kinds of technology, delivery platforms, molecular targets. One of these is already in phase one trials to test for safety. There's another that has reached the phase three trial phase to actually injecting people and testing whether it provides an effective protection against seasonal influenza viruses that will be circulating this year and next. And the federal government, just this year, is investing $190 million in the effort to develop a universal flu vaccine. And there is an act under consideration now that would invest another $1 billion over the next 5 years. So our study suggests that if we replace the current seasonal flu vaccine with a universal flu vaccine that's 75% effective at preventing infection against any kind of flu virus, that we would essentially reduce the burden by over 50%. That is, the number of deaths, the number of infections, the number of hospitalizations would go down by more than half. What's even more exciting potentially about a universal flu vaccine is it may be our great hope in preventing a really devastating future pandemic caused by a new influenza virus emerging from animal populations into human populations. But I still have a job. And that is because we still face a serious flu burden every year, a serious threat of a severe influenza virus in the future. And for those of us who are trying to forecast when it's going to emerge, how it's going to spread, how the virus itself might evolve, we still find the influenza very elusive. So let's start by talking about the burden today. So seasonal influenza every year causes epidemics all over the world. Globally, it causes 3 to 5 million severe cases of disease and hundreds of thousands of deaths. Here in the United States, when we look back over the last couple decades, the annual burden is an average of 28 million people infected, 461,000 hospitalizations, and 40,500 deaths, just from our regular garden variety seasonal flu. So when I think about influenza as a scientist, I usually have, let me mention one other thing. So what is in our public health arsenal? What sorts of tools do we have at our disposal to prevent the transmission of flu and to save lives? Well, our most important tool is the influenza vaccine depicted here. So have you gotten your flu shot this year? Yeah, good. Well, if you haven't, you probably should. It's not a silver bullet. It's not guaranteed to prevent you from getting infected, but it'll probably lower the probability that you'll be infected this year. And sometimes we get it right with the flu vaccine, and sometimes we don't. This is a graph showing the flu effectiveness over the last, 14 years or so. So how do we measure flu effectiveness? Well, what we're doing is we're basically comparing the people who got vaccinated with the people who didn't get vaccinated. And the effectiveness, like last year's 28% effectiveness, means the people that did get vaccinated had a 28% lower chance of getting influenza last year. So the effectiveness varies from year to year based on whether the vaccines cover the viruses that actually end up spreading around the globe. So what else do we have in our arsenal besides the flu vaccine? Well, we also have antiviral medications. And as of this year, the FDA has approved 4 different kinds of antiviral medications. The most well-known and widely used one is oseltamivir. That goes under the trade name of Tamiflu. And the most recent one that was just approved is called baloxavir, and it goes under the trade name of Xofluza. And the early clinical evidence is that drug may even be more effective in reducing the severity of illness and protecting people who are at high risk and shortening the window of symptoms and transmission. In addition to these drugs, we also have a whole suite of what we call non-pharmaceutical interventions that don't require vaccines or drugs. That includes hygienic precautions like washing your hands, sneezing into a tissue, keeping your distance from somebody who is sneezing and obviously has symptoms. and also what we call social distancing measures or social distancing interventions, like closing schools or shutting down public gatherings or stopping modes of transportation just to prevent people from coming in contact with each other. So now I'll get to the part I was going to get to earlier. What do I have in mind when I am thinking as a scientist about influenza? Usually I have one of two types of pictures. Either the picture of a network, which is what we talked about last night, the patterns of interactions around the globe, locally, even within households and hospitals that fuel the transmission of influenza. Or I'm thinking about an image that looks something like this, a time series graph. And we call this kind of graph an influenza curve, or a flu curve for short. And I'm going to show you a few of these tonight, so let me orient you. Along the x-axis, we usually have time. And in this case, we have about 20 years going from the 1998 flu season all the way to the most recent flu season. And along the y-axis, we have some measure of how much flu there is right now in the population, how many people are currently infected. In this particular graph, these highest peaks indicate that there are about 50 million people infected with flu that week of the year in the United States. So what is this telling us about what seasonal flu has done over the last 20 years? Well, if we go back to the earliest year, the earliest season, this is the 1998-1999 influenza season, it started increasing, cases started rising, people started spreading the disease when kids went to school in the fall. It peaked in February, and then it subsided in the spring and went away for the summer, as almost every single flu season does. The next season looked similar, a little higher, peaking in February. The next one peaked a little bit earlier in December. And then we had a whole bunch of flu seasons, high, low, medium, peaking anywhere from as early as December to as late as February. And then this season in red is not your typical flu season. That was actually the 2009 H1N1 pandemic, which we discussed quite a bit last night. It emerged out of Mexico, around the globe, including in the US, at the end of April. Had an early summer peak, subsided in the later summer a little bit, and then came back with a vengeance in the early fall, peaking in October. And then we didn't see a flu season at the normal flu season time of year. We didn't see much flu come February and March of 2010. Following that pandemic, it was back to flu as normal, with seasons peaking anywhere between December and March. The 2017-18 season, not last year, but the year before, was the most severe on record, with an estimated 80,000 people who died in the US alone from that seasonal strain. So let's talk a little bit about the flu virus itself that is driving this curve. So there are actually four different types of flu viruses. We actually call them types: type A, type B, type C, and creatively named type D. And so what are these different types? Well, A, the one we're really mostly going to talk about tonight is A, but A and B are the two different types of influenza viruses that cause our annual epidemics. C is a type of influenza that actually infects people occasionally, but it doesn't typically spread epidemically, and it tends to cause more mild disease. And D is a type that's found primarily in cattle and doesn't infect humans. So let's focus now on A and B. So these are the vaccines that were, these are the viruses that were driving that curve. There are two types of A. We call them subtypes. There's H1N1 and H3N2. And there's two types of B, but we call them lineages. And the two lineages of B are the Yamagata and the Victoria. Now we're going to focus a little bit closer now on A. So what do these H's and these N's mean? H1, N1, H3, N2? Well, the H and the N stand for two different proteins that are on the surface of the flu virus that are really pivotal in interacting with our immune system and interacting with the vaccines. They're proteins that allow the virus to infect our cells, and they're also proteins that allow our body to recognize the virus and hopefully eliminate it. So the H stands for hemagglutinin. And we know of 18 different types of hemagglutinins that have actually been found in flu viruses in humans and animals, many of which have been found only in wild birds. And so there are only two types of H's in the commonly circulating human flu viruses. That's the H1 and the H3 on this wheel of different of H's. And then the N stands for neuraminidase. And there are 11 different neuraminidase types known. And again, there are only two that appear in our seasonal strains. There's N1 and N2. But there are many other combinations of these, of different H's and different N's that appear in influenza viruses and other types of animals. So you can imagine spinning these two wheels and see where you end up. Maybe you end up with an H11, N6. Now, not all of these combinations have actually been found in nature, but there are many that have. There are over 9 different types of H5s in wild birds, and 9 different types of H7s in wild birds, and 9 different types of H9s with different kinds of N's attached to them in wild birds. So let's zoom in a little bit deeper now. Let's just look at H3N2, one of our common subtypes. So H3N2 is not a single virus. It is a large collection of rapidly evolving viruses that all just happen to have similar hemagglutinin and neuraminidase proteins. What you see here on the right is a phylogenetic tree or an evolutionary tree that was created by Trevor Bedford's group at the Fred Hutch Institute. Each one of these different circles represents an actual flu virus that was collected from an infected person and typed in a lab. And the closer these things are to each other, the more similar they are to each other genetically and immunologically. And the different colors represent groups or clusters of H3N2 viruses that are sort of similar immunologically. So if you develop a vaccine against oranges, it may not actually provide any protection against greens or blues, even though they're all H3N2s. If we just zoom in on the most recent swath here in the last year, you can see that the viruses that are circulating just right now all over the globe are actually quite diverse. So let's go back to our flu curve that we were looking at before, although I've truncated it a bit. And let's ask which subtypes and types of viruses actually caused our seasonal influenza outbreaks. So in the 2007-08 season, this pie chart tells us that the majority or the dominant type that year, subtype that year, was H1N1. And there was sort of an even split between B and H3N2 in terms of the proportion of human infections caused by the different viruses. The next year was dominated by H3N2. The year after that was dominated once again by H1N1. And then came the pandemic. And the pandemic introduced a new H1N1 that was very, very different from the previously circulating H1N1, so different that really very few people had any immunity to it, and so it caused a major pandemic. And that was the only virus really circulating in any significant frequency that year. The following year, what we discovered was that new H1N1 that arrived, the pandemic strain, completely outcompeted and eradicated the old H1N1 from human circulation. But the bees stuck around, and so did H3N2. So in the years following, it sort of alternated. The following season was dominated by H3N2, and then it sort of flip-flops between either majority H3N2, majority H1N1, and B is always a smaller proportion than the A types. So that is the sort of recent last couple decades of influenza in sort of cliff note version. And now let's go back in time. So let's go back very far back in time. So the first pandemic that people have dug up from the historical record probably occurred in the late 1500s. And between the late 1500s and the end of the 19th century, there were about 30 other pandemics in the historical record, at least one of which was just as bad as our 1918 flu, which brings us to the 20th century. So this graph is now going from 1900 to 2000. And the y-axis is essentially how many people died from flu each year. And you see, and during the 20th century, there were 4 pandemics, 4 introductions of brand new flu viruses into the human population that didn't look very much or anything like the flu viruses that were circulating at the time. And because of that, there was the whole population was susceptible, or most of the population was susceptible, and we had very large epidemics. And we also had new kinds of viruses come in and start to cause our seasonal epidemics thereafter. So 1918, the most notorious, the most devastating, the thing that still fuels our nightmares, the Spanish flu pandemic. It was an H1N1. It's estimated to have killed at least 40 million people, but estimates go up to 100 million people around the world in a matter of just a few months. 40 million people in 1918. That was around the same time. That was the same time as World War I, right? World War I altogether killed 16 million people. So this flu killed more than twice as many people as World War I killed at the same point in history. The next pandemic occurred in 1957. Between 1918 and 1957, it was viruses that descended from that Spanish flu H1N1 that caused our seasonal epidemics. The Asian flu came in 1957. It completely replaced the H1N1 that had been circulating and caused seasonal epidemics after that. In 1968, we had the Hong Kong flu and another replacement of the circulating virus. In 1977, we had our fourth pandemic, but it was actually not a new virus coming from birds or livestock. It was actually a virus that escaped from a lab in China near the Russian border. And because H1N1 hadn't been circulating for many, many years, there was a lot of susceptibility in the population, and it caused essentially pandemic-scale transmission. And then after that, following H1N1, H1N1 didn't actually replace H3N2. Both of them circulated together, and then both of them circulated until the most recent 2009 pandemic, which we just discussed, and we saw how that virus came in and swept through. More recently, we have seen other threats, what we call pre-pandemic strains of flu or viruses. These are viruses that have infected humans but don't have the ability to spread from person to person. Mostly it's people coming in contact with infected birds or infected pigs, getting infected. And these are all quite severe. They have high case fatality rates, and we are concerned that they might evolve the ability to spread from person to person, and so we're keeping an eye on them. But for now, they're classified as pre-pandemic. So let's talk a little bit about the history of public health with respect to influenza. The first influenza vaccines were developed in the early 1940s, first just against A, and then combined against types A and type B. Modern surveillance to keep track of which kind of influenza types and subtypes were circulating started in the 1950s. And then in the 1970s, they started the practice of every year annually updating the vaccines, looking carefully at what is circulating around the globe and incorporating them in the next year's flu vaccine. So before I wind up the sort of introductory material, I just want to make a couple comments on the difference between pandemics and seasonal flu. So besides the fact that just by definition, pandemics are brand new strains coming in where we don't have any immunity, there are some important differences between how they spread and what they do in the human population. So first of all, the attack rate, just how many people get infected, tends to be higher with pandemics because there is less immunity or no immunity at all in the population. And virulence. Some of our pandemics, like the 1918 flu, are particularly virulent, much more deadly than our seasonal flu, but not all of them. 2009 H1N1 was not particularly virulent. And then there are two other things that tend to be different between pandemics and seasonal outbreaks. That is the wave structure, those sort of curves that I showed you earlier, and the timeline for developing a vaccine. And let me talk about both those things briefly. So, this is what our typical seasonal wave looks like. You know, it comes up in the fall, peaks in the winter, and disappears in the summer. A single wave, maybe with a little blip at the top. When we look back in history, we see that many of our major pandemics arrived in multiple waves. 1918 had a small summer wave, a large fall wave, and then another kind of intermediate winter wave in February, March-ish. 1957 had a large fall wave and then another large winter wave, all in the same year. On the same school year. And then 2009 had depending on where you were, a small to medium summer wave, and then a large fall wave peaking in October, and then no wave at all in the winter. So pandemics have different and unpredictable wave structure and come at different times a year in comparison to our seasonal epidemics. And then the vaccine timeline. For seasonal flu, our flu season has hardly started, but most of us are already vaccinated. So we have vaccines ready before the outbreak starts. With pandemics, we are probably not going to be so lucky. Pandemics catch us by surprise. We don't even know they're there until they've already infected a significant number of people, and it takes us a while to figure out what's going on and get the vaccine production cycle in gear. So let's look at what actually happened in 2019. The first cases started to increase in March of 2009. The virus was first identified in late April. By late June, we actually had a vaccine candidate, so that means actually a specific virus that we could use to make a vaccine against. On June 11th, the WHO actually declared we have a pandemic, and that really got things in gear in terms of launching the vaccine production. Pharmaceutical companies, global health organizations, they put on all the engines. They tried to accelerate the production as quickly as possible, but they ran into some difficulty. The vaccines are grown up in eggs. The viruses are grown up in eggs when producing the vaccines, and these viruses happen to grow quite slowly in eggs. And so it took quite a while. It took until September for the first vaccines to be licensed, approved for use. And it wasn't until December 1st that we had a lot of doses available and starting to be distributed out to states, out to doctors, and start to vaccinate people. So it was actually 6 full months between identifying what virus we were going to make a vaccine against and having enough vaccines available to start really vaccinating people on a large scale. And by that time, what you see there in the background was the course of the 2009 pandemic. By the time we had vaccines ready, the major wave had run its course, and it was sort of too late for vaccines to have a big impact on transmission. So because of that, because in most scenarios that we can envision for a future pandemic, at least right now, it'll take us a while to get a vaccine. And because of that, we have to use the other tools in our arsenal to stop or to slow the spread of the disease and to save lives. So non-pharmaceutical interventions, social distancing can actually make a huge difference. There was a fascinating study published in 2007 by Richard Hatchett et al., in which they looked back in the historical record at 1918 flu, and they looked at what kinds of non-pharmaceutical social distancing interventions different cities implemented and the timing of those interventions. So for example, in Philadelphia first identified that there was this strange and deadly virus spreading in the middle of September, yet 10 days later, they had a major civic parade where there were tons of people out interacting with each other. And it wasn't until almost 3 weeks later that they realized they really had to clamp down on things and shut down schools and prohibit social gatherings and take other precautionary measures. And that was just too late. They experienced a very large, very devastating wave of transmission. In contrast, St. Louis didn't identify its first cases until October 5th. It had the benefit of seeing what was happening in the rest of the country and knowing that they had to do something quickly. By 2 days later, by October 7th, they had implemented all sorts of very strict non-pharmaceutical interventions, including closing schools, and the outcome was very different. They really spared their population the same fate as Philadelphia. So social distancing measures can be vital in protecting a population. And then antivirals. So this was a slide I showed you last night as well. It's a slide based on a model that we developed to help the US government figure out how best to use our strategic national stockpile of 80 million antivirals to slow transmission and save lives during the 2009 H1N1 pandemic. And I'm not going to go into the details again tonight, but that's just to say that we do stockpile antivirals because they can be absolutely key to saving lives, particularly for deadly strains of pandemic virus early in a pandemic before vaccines are available. So now we're getting to the meat of the talk on forecasting influenza. And I'm going to start by just talking about the enterprise as a whole. What are our forecasting goals? What are the opportunities and what are the challenges we face as we start to think about forecasting both epidemics and pandemics? So what is it that we actually would like to be able to forecast if we had the right kind of data and the right kind of models? Well, many different things. We would like to forecast what's about to happen in the 2019-2020 season. When is it going to start? Where is it going to start? What time of year, what week of the year is it going to peak? How many people are going to be infected and end up in hospitals and need emergency care the week of the peak? We want to know next season. We want to look forward and figure out for the 2020-2021 season, which viruses should we be covering in our vaccine strain, in our vaccines? We want to know when the next pandemic is going to occur, where it's going to emerge on the face of the globe, how severe it's going to be, what we need to do to get ready. And then we also, if we can't forecast all these things with great precision or accuracy, we would like to be able to at least predict what kinds of interventions are going to be most effective at controlling pandemics across a variety of scenarios. So I really don't know much about weather forecasting, but I do want to just make some quick comparisons about very dramatic differences between an area of forecasting that is very mature and we're all very familiar with and the area of forecasting I'm going to talk about tonight. So first of all, just the time and the effort and the investment and the technology that has been devoted to building the modern weather forecasting enterprise is monumental compared to what we do for flu, or what we've done so far for flu. According to the history books, weather forecasting, sort of modern forecasting, has its origins back around 1840 with the invention of the electric telegraph. It allowed people to instantly transmit weather conditions from one side of the state or one side of the country or the city to anywhere they wanted. By 1860, newspapers had daily weather maps that reflected the forecast from all these conditions that people were learning about. And fast forward to today, this year's federal budget for what they call the Federal Weather Enterprise is over $4 billion. And that's going to NOAA, National Weather Service, and FAA, and all the different agencies that really depend on and are advancing the weather forecasting enterprise. So the second, and with flu forecasting, well, we've just begun, and we're really hoping to go from 0 to 60 in a fraction of the time that weather forecasting has matured. The second major difference is the system we're trying to forecast. Now, we could get into a debate about which is a more complex system, but certainly they're both complex, and they're complex in different ways. So with weather, you're modeling the physical environment, you're modeling your hydrodynamic processes, physical processes. With flu, you're modeling not only the physical environment, you understand not only the physical environment, but you're also trying to forecast what's happening with multiple different dynamic biological systems that are interacting with each other. And you may, if you were here last night, you may recognize this slide as well, but we have the virus that's replicating within individuals and interfacing with immune systems that can be quite variable depending on a person's age, what they ate, how much they slept, where they live on the face of the earth. And then there's the dynamics of transmission within animals and between animals and humans. And then there is the climate, which also affects disease transmission and how people make decisions. Do they get vaccinated? Are they traveling? Where are they traveling? And then there's the organizational interventions from the WHO and the CDC. All these things contribute to the fate of an epidemic. And all these things may have to be factored in when making forecasts. So the system is much more complex. And then the final comparison I want to make is the data. If you go on Weather Underground, which is a decent website, I think, for getting today's forecast or tomorrow's forecast, and you look up where are they getting their data, well, they're getting their data from over 180,000 different weather stations, including private weather stations and federal weather stations. And some of those weather stations are reporting conditions, you know, precipitation, humidity, wind, temperature, multiple different variables at a resolution of every 2.5 seconds. So you're talking about volumes of data today, volumes of data yesterday, volumes of data for decades past. And all of that data allows us to learn how weather behaves and learn what the pattern today might imply for the pattern tomorrow. With flu, well, if we want to predict a pandemic, the data we have on pandemics, I mean, I can count the number of pandemics we have data on one hand, right? And that data is really sparse, can be biased, not very reliable. If you want to predict seasonal flu, well, maybe we have a few decades or maybe a century of data, but that's 100 data points, basically. So we have so little data, and the epidemiological data can be very sparse and difficult to work with. And it's not just that we want epidemiological data, we actually need data that reflects all the different parts of all the different drivers of the system. And so the kind of data that we may need and we are starting to use includes molecular data that tells us something about the viruses and how they interface with the immune system and how they're evolving. It includes census data, transportation data, health surveys, vaccination data, electronic health records, GPS that tells us where people are based on their phone, cell phones, that tells us where people are, diversity in the human population, species distributions, livestock tracking, climate data, we know where we can find that. Google, Twitter, Wikipedia, Facebook, it could tell us something about what decisions people are making, where people are. And then if we want to know what kinds of interventions are happening, there's outbreak reports from public health agencies and news outlets. So I'm going to dive a little bit deeper into the kind of data we're using. Let's talk about the health data. And what I mean by health data is that this is data that is actually based on real disease in the population. So what kind of health data do we look at? Well, there's the kind of surveillance data that I showed you earlier. These graphs are based on the CDC's ILINET, influenza-like illness network that we discussed last night. Basically, thousands of doctor's offices and clinics around the country every week report two numbers: how many patients they saw altogether that week, and what fraction of those patients had influenza-like illness. And that's how we monitor how much flu there is in the US population. There's molecular data taken out of labs that are actually testing flu viruses that come from people that are infected. And then really sort of next-gen data, electronic health records data. So now, today, there are major data service providers for hospitals where you can get, in one location, you can get data from hundreds of thousands of different facilities all across the United States, which is every single patient record. How many people every hour of every day go to clinics and hospitals around the country for different kinds of complaints? Then there's the proxy data, the stuff that's actually not directly reflecting that somebody showed up in a doctor's office with flu or with something that looks like flu. And I'm going to call this digital data, even though most data is digital these days. But this is data that comes from the internet or comes from social media. And the idea of using this proxy data was first introduced by Google itself in 2009. They published this really sort of revolutionary paper in Nature in which they introduced something they called Google Flu Trends. They had this hypothesis that when somebody gets sick or someone in their family gets sick, what's one of the first things you do? You go to your computer and you Google fever, sore throat, aches, Tamiflu, or you know, whatever is on your mind when you're sick or you know someone who's sick. So their hypothesis was, well, if we just track how many people per day or how many queries we're getting every day in Google for words like that, we may actually get something that correlates with how much flu there really is out there in the US population. And they were right. They used machine learning to figure out what combination of about 40 different search terms would give them time series that most closely matched the CDC. So this was the time series in blue that they produced with their model. And in orange is the actual real surveillance time series from the CDC for that same period of time. And from there, Google Flu Trends expanded. They did it on many different scales. They eventually disbanded it. It used to be a free online service, public health service. They eventually disbanded it, but you can still yourself go on and make your own Google Flu Trends if you want. And now many people in the field have come up with creative ways of mining other kinds of data like this. How many people are hitting on the Wikipedia page for influenza each day? How many people are tweeting, or how many tweets are out there that mention flu or mention vaccine, et cetera? And the final category of data is socio-environmental data. We know that the transmission of flu is influenced by humidity. So there's your picture of a weather station here, and we know it's strongly influenced by the school calendar. And so we use data reflecting both of these socio-environmental factors as well. So let's now progress to seeing some of the very beginnings of our attempts to forecast seasonal and pandemic flu, starting with seasonal epidemics. So on November 25th of 2013, the CDC announced its first flu forecasting contest. It was called the Predict the Influenza Season Challenge, and it was exactly what it sounds like. It was come and try to use your best models, whatever data you can get your hands on, and predict what's going to happen over the next 4 months. We were already in November, and they want us to predict it from that day forward. And in fact, the first submission of the prediction must be received by December 2nd. So we had about a week to figure this out. And so my group at UT, we scrambled, and I think there might have been 13 or 15, somewhere between 15 and 20 different groups around the country did the same thing. It was so exciting. We'd all been thinking about forecasting. Some of us had started, but there had been no kind of concerted effort to really move this thing forward. And so the CDC said, let's do this. And whereas the federal government invested $4.3 billion this year in weather forecasting, the CDC said, and please do this for free. And we all did, gladly. It was very exciting. OK, so what was the challenge? The challenge was It was 2013. This is what actually happened. We were back here in November. The challenge was, can you forecast what's about to happen? And in particular, can you tell us when flu season is going to start, when this kind of surveillance line is going to cross a specified threshold, when it's going to peak, how high that peak is going to be, and when it's going to subside back below our, down below our baseline. And so we used a model that we had sort of been thinking about. It was a common filter Bayesian model, and it allowed us to integrate all these different kinds of data. We looked at the CDC's surveillance data. We looked at Google flu trends. We looked at the school calendar, and we looked at humidity data. We incorporated it all. We tried to make a forecast. We submitted our forecast on a sort of, I think it was almost a weekly basis. We were supposed to each week forecast the next week, and this is how we did. We didn't do so well. I mean, we were at the emergence of flu, so we got that right. But our peak was really pretty far off, both, you know, in many weeks off and in terms of the height. And we were also a little bit off in when it would subside. But it was as good as we could do. And we did it on the fly. And we didn't win, sadly. But the team that won, and the team had a really great model, like, and theirs was really the most advanced, has really pushed the field forward. Their forecast actually really wasn't any better than ours. It was just as, they were all way off. However, it was sort of the artistry. Like, they just had a much more elegant model, and they had already published it, and it was really great. And their model really is very cool. It's a modeling project led by Jeff Shaman at Columbia University, and you can go onto his website, and you can go to any city you want. Like, this was, I didn't see Santa Fe, but I did see Albuquerque, and I pulled up, this was the forecast back from Saturday, March 23rd, 2019, so that was from last flu season. So they were making the forecast at that point in time. So you'd seen this is what flu had done so far, and they forecasted it would do this. I don't know what it actually did, but they also show you what their prior forecasts had done. Back here, when flu actually went like that, they forecasted it would go like that. So, I mean, this is state of the art, but we are still very far from being able to make, you know, accurate and precise forecasts of even what's going to happen 2 weeks out. In our major cities in the United States. I do want to mention one other approach. So since our first attempt with the common filter, we have tried to work a little bit more to improve forecasting methods. And the whole enterprise of forecasting really benefits from different groups taking different approaches and learning from each other along the way. The approach that I'm going to talk about was actually introduced in a paper by Brooks et al. This is a group out of Carnegie Mellon. And the method they use is an empirical Bayesian machine learning method. But I'm going to try to explain it in terms that aren't quite so fancy and just give you some intuition for how this method actually works. So the idea is, you know, I told you earlier, like maybe we have 20 or maybe at most 100 flu seasons to learn from. And so here are some flu seasons. These are some real flu seasons. These are the same curves I showed you before, but just stretched out and stacked on top of each other. What we would really like to know, so these are real flu seasons, but what we would really like to know is what is the universe of possible flu seasons that could happen? Right here are a few, but it would be very plausible if one kind of went like that and one went like that. And so what this method does is it takes the flu seasons we've actually seen and it simulates millions or hundreds of millions of plausible flu seasons and uses that universe of plausible flu seasons to forecast what's going to happen in the coming weeks in the current flu season. So how does it do that? Well, it takes each one of these curves and it just measures five different things. It says, squint your eyes and fit a nice smooth curve. And what does that curve look like? We're going to call that the shape. Now, let's just measure the time between where it passes the threshold in the beginning and where it goes back down below the threshold at the end. We'll call that the space, the pace, I'm sorry. So that's just like the duration of the flu season. Then let's measure when the peak happens, and let's measure how high the peak is. And the fifth thing we're going to measure is how noisy that flu season was. So how far and how much did that actual flu season jiggle or depart from our nice smooth curve? Okay, so we're going to go and we're going to measure each of those five things for the data that we actually have. So I can measure the flu peak there. And now I have a distribution of actual flu peaks that happened. So now when I want to go and generate a universe of plausible flu seasons or flu curves, what I do is I just make hybrids, okay, or I make chimeras. I'm going to take a pace from one season And I'm going to take a shape from another season and a height and a peak timing and a noise from randomly chosen seasons, and I'm going to mash them all up and I'm going to make a plausible flu season. And I'm going to do that over and over again. And like I said, I'm going to have millions. So now what am I going to do with all these plausible flu seasons that are sort of indistinguishable from the ones that actually happened? Well, now I have real flu. You know, it's like December of 2019, and I want to forecast what's going to happen for the rest of the season. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to compare it to some randomly chosen seasons from flu seasons, flu curves from this universe of flu curves, and I'm going to see which one it matches, and I'm going to do some sort of fancy averaging, and I'm going to use that to predict what's going to happen. So the ones that look most like the beginning of my flu season, I'm going to use those to project what might happen, and I'm going to thereby forecast my flu season. And that method works pretty well. It works about as well as all the other methods, or sometimes even better than some of the other methods I mentioned. So that was introduced by another team. And what we did with this model is we extended it so that we could into what we call a multivariate model, so that we could try to use lots of different kinds of data in learning about past flu seasons, in making these forecasts. And we coupled it to an optimization model that allowed us to test lots of different possible data sources and figure out which predictors, which data sources gave us the best forecasts. So we actually considered hundreds of different data sources and figured out what combination of these data sources made the best predictions. They were public health data, they were electronic health records data from a data service company called Athena Health, and then we had Google data sources and Wikipedia, and we even looked at how many blogs on WordPress were mentioning flu. And what we found was that the best predictions, the best model, used a combination of real traditional CDC surveillance data and the electronic health records data. And the digital data, the internet source data, really didn't improve things much. And when we added the electronic health records data to the surveillance data, to the data that we've been using forever to forecast and monitor flu, it really did measurably improve performance. It reduced the error by 15 to 20%, and it improved our predictions of when the peak would happen by a good 5 days. We got 5 days closer on average. And these are some examples of what I call backcast. We went back and we said, let's pretend we didn't know what happened in 2005 and make a forecast from this point on, from where you see the gray start. And the black's the actual curve, the red is what we predicted, and the gray is our uncertainty. And some of these we did okay, and some of these we did not so okay. So that's predicting the shape of the season. Now let's talk about predicting the virus. Now, why do we want to predict the virus? Well, this is perhaps one of the most important forecasting challenges we face right now, one with potentially the biggest positive impact on public health if we nail this one, and that is predicting which flu strains are actually going to be spreading next year so that we can put the right ones in the flu vaccine. Right? That 28% flu effectiveness from last year, it's because of one of two things or some combination of the two. It's either because we made the wrong prediction of what was going to circulate, or it's because during the manufacturing process, when the viruses were growing in eggs, the virus adapted to life in the eggs, which caused it to look and the vaccine to end up not matching well with the virus that was circulating. So why is this prediction problem so hard? Well, it's because the public health community and the pharmaceutical community decides in March every year what needs to be in the flu shot that's administered in September, October, November of that year, 6 months later, to protect us against something that's going to be circulating maybe 9 months later. So how can we do a better job of forecasting where these flu viruses are going to evolve? And the one thing I didn't mention when I put these up last time, this picture up last time, was what are these X's? Well, these X's indicate when one of these viruses was chosen to be included in a new flu vaccine. So you can see that as the colors change, we update the vaccines to reflect the changing landscape of what's actually spreading. Okay, so there are many groups that are kind of grappling with the real data, with data like this, trying to come up with better statistical models, better predictive models of what's going to happen in that evolutionary tree, which viruses are going to dominate next year. In a recent study, we took a slightly different approach. We asked the question, suppose you had perfect information. Suppose you could see every single flu virus on Earth that's infecting every single person who's infected right now. Then, if we could see all that data, perfect data, then what would be the best model for predicting what's going to be circulating 6 or 9 months from now? And what is going to be the limits to our ability to forecast? How far out could we actually forecast? And to do this study, we used a simulation model that was developed by Katja Cole and David Rasmussen and published in 2015. And it's a really detailed, very realistic simulation of influenza A, H3N2, spreading across the globe and evolving while it's spreading. So it actually has mutations and fitness for these different viruses. And you can then, in a computer, sort of watch these epidemics and the underlying evolution of the virus unfold. So this is an example of the output of the model. So this is 25 years of influenza transmission and evolution. Each one of these peaks corresponds to an epidemic peak. So the top is just like those curves we've seen. It's how many people are actually infected. And the colors below the peak indicate that which viruses are doing the infecting. So if it's just one monolithic color like that, that means it's an epidemic that's dominated by a single type of H3N2. But if you see a very colorful peak like this, it means that there's four different H3N2 clusters all circulating at once. There's a green and a blue and a whatever. Okay, so this is what the, so this is sort of a hypothetical world. This is a realistic simulation of flu evolving through time. And so what the objective is, you know, we want to very early on, when you see a new cluster just emerging, when it's just at 1% or 5% of all flus present, we want to be able to predict, is this going to be the one that's going to end up being the dominant strain in the next flu season, or is it going to kind of fizzle out just like this gray one did? So this is one that fizzles out, whereas this beige one ends up being quite large. We want to identify that beige one because we want to put it in the flu vaccine. So, and here's another example where we want to predict which ones of these, there's a bunch of them down there, we wanted to be able to predict that the purple and the pink are the ones that are going to make it. So we considered many different possible predictors, many different things you could measure in this population where you have full information, and many different kinds of ways of modeling, using those measurements to predict what's going to happen. So we could just look at the overall prevalence, how many people are currently infected at the time that a new cluster is emerging. Or we could look at what kinds of mutations and how many mutations are on the new cluster. Or we can look at how quickly is that new cluster growing, and we can compare all of these kinds of things in the cluster that we're trying to predict to what's going on in the background, what's happening with all the other viruses in the population at that time. And what we found when we considered many different models and many different variables is that the best predictors of which one of these viruses would end up being the one we want to vaccinate against was the growth rate of that virus, so how fast it was increasing, how fast is that orange curve increasing, and also when you need to look at the growth rates of all the other viruses that are around at the same time and measure the variance in those growth rates. So those two things turned out to be the best predictors of whether or not a cluster is going to make it. If it has a high growth rate and there's not a lot of variance in growth rates in the population at the time, it has a good chance of being the next one to dominate. So this is just a snapshot of the performance of our best model. Here is that same simulated flu curve. Here what you see is basically this curve stretched or normalized. So all you're looking at now is what proportion of the viruses are the different colors, the different kinds of viruses. So all these brightly colored ones are ones that eventually were dominant that we would have wanted to vaccinate against. And the colors you see down here are the ones that we correctly predicted. We predicted early that those ones were ones that were going to eventually dominate. And here you see our best model missed these two. There were only two that were false negatives, where we said we don't need to worry about them when we really should have worried about them. So it turns out what we've learned from this study is that there is a prediction trade-off, that there's a trade-off between how early you can know whether something's going to be a threat and how accurately you can predict which ones are going to be a threat. So, you know, we might want to, here's an emerging flu cluster, and we might want to be able to predict as early as the first virus appears, or maybe we're willing to wait till a little bit later, or even later than that. And what we find, and what we're gonna see in this graph, this is the lead time, how much time you'd have to develop the vaccine. More time is better. What percent of the actual threats we detected correctly. And what we see is that if we try to detect them really early, we can get almost a year, maybe 9 months or so lead time, but we only end up detecting maybe 68% of those that we really should have vaccinated. So we're going to miss, you know, a good 30% that we want to vaccinate again and leave our population vulnerable. And then we can look a little bit later, and we can see this trade-off that as you look later and later, you get more information, you're better able to make those predictions, but your lead time dwindles to, you know, almost sort of 6 months. There's sort of the sweet spot where we've done the best we're going to do in terms of the performance, how well we can predict, and the amount of time we get to develop our vaccines is just 6 months. So this is a scenario where we have perfect information. It is possible that with even better models, we could improve this forecasting horizon, but this is the best we did. And we have far from perfect information in the real world. So something's gotta give, and what that is maybe the vaccine production cycle. So maybe we'll come up with better methods to forecast, but it would be really great if we could figure out a way to accelerate that time between identifying which viruses we wanna vaccinate against and actually getting those vaccines out to people so that we can make those decisions in July or August instead of in March. So let's turn now briefly to forecasting pandemics. So, a couple weeks before the 2009 H1N1 pandemic started spreading, I was in a room with a bunch of modelers, folks from UT who worked with me at UT, and a bunch of people who worked for the state of Texas. And the state of Texas Public Health Department was interested in possibly having us build some models of pandemic transmission in Texas that they could use to plan for the next pandemic. And at the time, you know, the great concern was H5N1, the avian virus that was spreading in Asia. And we all sat around the room and we were discussing what should this model look like? And specifically, where should we assume that importations are gonna happen? Where are the first cases gonna arrive in Texas if we get a deadly pandemic? And all the experts in the room, all the scientists and all the public health officials, they all said, okay, it's gonna come in through one of our major airports, Houston, Dallas-Fort Worth, and it's gonna come from an international flight from Asia. And so, or maybe it'll come domestically, but we really got to look at those big airports and those big cities. And there was someone in the room who was not an epidemiologist. She was a graduate student, and she was just helping with some data collection because she wanted to get some experience, first-time experience in this kind of world. And she said, well, you know, what about Mexico? Isn't it possible it could come over the border from Mexico? And all the experts and officials in the room said, no way, we don't have to worry about Mexico. And 2 weeks later, the next pandemic came over the border from Mexico. Some of the very first cases were in the San Antonio area, and we were totally wrong. And we were also thinking, well, you know, when is this gonna happen? It's gonna happen 5 years from now. No, 2 weeks later out of Mexico. So we really have no idea, even though we're watching all these viruses, you know, particularly in Asia, we really have no idea when, where, from what kind of population the next pandemic is going to arrive. And we are really very far from being able to forecast that. In this study, we asked one very simple question that just takes a baby step in that direction, and that is, what time of year will the next pandemic arrive? Not what year, not what part of the globe, but just what time of year will it arrive? And so, where do we start? Well, we look at when does seasonal influenza spread, right? So these are all of our epi curves that I showed you earlier, but they're superimposed. So when does flu spread? Well, it spreads at that time of year, right? And so one might imagine that if there is gonna be a pandemic, probably it would spread at that time of year, right? Because that's when maybe the climate is good and people are coming into contact with each other. So is that when pandemics spread or when they emerge? Well, no, that is not when pandemics spread. This is the weeks of emergence for all the major pandemics that we have on record since 1889. And not a single one of them emerged when we might have expected them to emerge. Not a single one emerged when flu typically spreads. So why is that? So in the study that we did recently, we had a hypothesis that one of the reasons that they don't arise during the normal flu season is because the normal flu season keeps them out. After people are infected with any flu virus, they have a period of temporary immunity against all flu viruses, or we think so. And it's estimated that that period of immunity may last around 7 weeks. So you get infected and you may sort of have a grace period before you're gonna be infected again if you become exposed to another flu virus. So that means that you have potentially a wake of immunity in the population as a whole. All these people have recently been infected, and so they're not gonna be susceptible, at least temporarily. And so that means that a new virus coming in may have a hard time getting a foothold if there's not a big enough susceptible population to spread to. So what that leads us to predict is if we now kind of flip this on its head, and this is now a curve just saying how susceptible is the population to a newly emerging pandemic, we might expect there to be a dip, or what we call a refractory period, when it's just not a good time of year for a pandemic to try to start spreading. And what's going on underneath the hood? Well, your population is totally susceptible, but in March, there are a lot of people, particularly people who are very connected in the contagion network, who are temporarily immune or resistant to transmission. And so it's just not possible for a new virus to spread very easily, but then the population reconstitutes itself and is once again susceptible to an outbreak taking hold. So that's the same curve I just showed you, but there's a couple other things we need to take into account in thinking about when a pandemic might emerge. And these are things that are now sort of well known or commonly accepted, let's say, about flu. One is that flu spreads better when school's in session than when it's not, because kids spread to each other. And two is that flu spreads better when humidity is lower, like in the winter, than not. It makes it easier for the viral particles to float from one person to another. And so when we take those things into account, when we take into account school and weather, we get kind of this modified curve where these peaks are when we most expect a pandemic to emerge. And when we backcast, we said, okay, let's see if this model works. Let's use our network model and let's put these simple assumptions in that we have a little immunity, we have the school, we have the weather. Let's look at 2008, 2009. That was the season preceding the emergence of pandemic flu, of pandemic 2009. That is what would have caused our wake. When we use that data to make a wake and we predict when would a pandemic emerge, if it was going to emerge, we get a prediction that corresponds very nicely to when the pandemic actually emerged. So this is a fairly parsimonious and plausible explanation for why flu pandemics emerged in the time of year they did in recent history. And it also gives us a forecast for when we may want to be on higher alert for potential emergence of new strains. And there's a couple other things that we sort of learned from this analysis. So for the next pandemic, or the most recent pandemic, when it first emerges, maybe in the late spring or early summer, it's probably emerging during a declining wake of immunity from the season. So what does that mean for the emerging pandemic? Well, one, it means that probably when it starts spreading, it's probably not spreading quite as fast as it's going to be able to in about a month or two. So what does that mean? Well, one thing that means is it might actually explain why we see that weird wave structure in those pandemics that I showed you earlier. The 1918 flu had that little wave, then a big wave. 2009 had a little wave and a big wave. So why is that? Well, maybe it gets going, but it can't quite get the foothold to spread to epidemic proportions because immunity is still kind of tamping down transmission. And then once that immunity completely declines, then it can really start spreading in full force. So that may provide an explanation for the pandemic wave structure and give us an expectation that in the future we might see small waves preceding much larger waves. And it also means, because pandemics are likely to pick up speed, that if we make estimates of R-naught, which we talked about last night, or how fast the flu is apt to spread, if we make those estimates based on its transmission patterns early on, we may underestimate its full potential. And so we need to very carefully calibrate our estimates based on what we know about the recent flu season. So finally, I will talk just very briefly about forecasting for intervention. So we are not very close to being able to forecast when, where, how quickly, how severely the next pandemic is going to spread. We're not even very close to forecasting exactly what's going to happen this flu season or what we need to vaccinate against next flu season in order to increase that vaccine effectiveness. Nonetheless, we still can forecast what kinds of intervention strategies are going to be most effective under a range of plausible scenarios. If we have a severe 1918 scenario, we can model that, and we can explore what combinations of vaccine strategies and antiviral strategies and non-pharmaceutical interventions are likely to be most effective at slowing the spread and saving lives. And we have been involved over the last 15 years in a large number of projects with different public health agencies from state to national and even international to build models, to build decision support tools that help them to think through interventions, to make preparedness plans. So for example, About 7 years ago, we made what we call the Texas Pandemic Flu Toolkit. It's an online resource for the state of Texas that has a bunch of different optimization models and simulation models and decision support models. It helps them to think through and make decisions using real data and optimization and kind of quantitative decision making about, for example, how many ventilators should we stockpile in the state of Texas to prepare for the surge in people that might need respiratory support during the peak of a pandemic? Should we keep them in a central stockpile, or should we have individual hospitals stockpile them locally? It helps them decide which specific pharmacies and grocery stores around the state will be best to enlist to help distribute antiviral drugs or even vaccines in an emergency. Or where should they set up vaccine pods to reach target high-risk populations as quickly as possible? And we've also worked with the state quite a bit to help them actually improve their data collection methodologies, their surveillance methodologies, so that they can get better real-time data on what's going on with diseases around the state. For some of these tools, we've built them not only in these online this online interface, but there's standalone apps for your computer, and we've built versions of them that can be run on this large wall of monitors in this really amazing space we have on UT campus called the Visualization Lab. It's affiliated with our supercomputer center, the Texas Advanced Computing Center, and we designed this so that groups of public health professionals can come in and actually run preparedness exercises and interact with the models, interact with unfolding epidemics in real time, and play around with different response strategies. So for my final slide, it's a video, and you might be able to see kind of what's going on here. It's a video of a desktop app of a simulation model that simulates the spread of an epidemic or a pandemic of influenza through the state of Texas. And this is something else we built for the Texas Department of State Health Services. And what the user can do is the user can specify exactly what kind of pandemic scenario they want to simulate. It can be spread quickly or spread slowly. It can be very severe or not so severe, and it can differ across age groups. It can start in Austin or in El Paso, or maybe there's cases all over the state. And then while a pandemic is unfolding in the simulation, they can implement different kinds of policies, different kinds of strategies. They can distribute vaccines to certain subgroups in the state or certain geographic locations. Same thing with antivirals. And they can implement non-pharmaceutical interventions like school closures that depress the transmission rate, either locally or throughout the state. And one of the coolest things, I think, about this model is that it allows the user to visualize what's going on in the simulation in two different ways. It can allow them to see what's actually happening as the simulated pandemic unfolds, how many people in every county are infected or recovered, but it also allows them to view what's going on in the simulation through a lens of a surveillance system. So we've actually modeled how flu data is collected in Texas. So when they look at it through that lens, what they're seeing is the kind of data they'd be seeing in real time if that kind of pandemic was spreading. And they can see what is the gap between what really goes on with flu and what they see through the data that we get on a daily or weekly basis. So this work has been really exciting, and I think we're really about to turn a corner in terms of bringing science and data to bear on helping with public health decision making. Just a couple months ago, the CDC launched their first large effort to get a bunch of different modeling groups that have been building state-of-the-art models on the transmission of influenza around the US and around the globe, to each advance their models, to work together, to compare their models, to collectively test out different intervention strategies, try to optimize intervention strategies, so that the government can really bring kind of the state of the art, the experts to the table, and helping them come up with pandemic preparedness plans. So let me just return to the title of tonight's lecture, which is The Elusive Threat of Influenza. So why did I call it The Elusive Threat of Influenza? Perhaps it's because of what we talked about last night. Influenza is a very short incubation period. Somebody gets infected, and they're already spreading disease to other people within a day or two before they may even know that they're sick. It makes it so much harder to control, so much more elusive than diseases like Ebola and SARS. Or maybe I called it elusive because it is caused by a virus that's not a virus, but it's millions of viruses that are constantly evolving, evolving in a way that's evading our body's defenses and evading our best international efforts to develop vaccines. Or maybe I called it elusive because of the inadequacy of our data and our models to forecast those really vital things that we want to forecast. So hopefully, there will be a universal flu vaccine, and we can make flu a thing of the past. But until then, flu is going to continue to exact a sizable human toll, and we're going to continue to keep chipping away at these models to do a better job at understanding and predicting the things we really want to predict. So let me close by just saying that even though people have been modeling the transmission dynamics of virus, of diseases, of viruses, even flu, for over 100 years, my field, which I'll call infectious disease dynamics, has really only come into existence in the last 15 years. Only recently do we have our own journals and our own conferences and even departments at some universities and even places where we can apply for grants that are dedicated to the kind of work we do. And the Santa Fe Institute has been really pivotal in nurturing this kind of science, the scientists who do it, and that bridge between science and public health. And for that, I really thank the Santa Fe Institute for all the support they've given to this endeavor, for having me here tonight. I also want to acknowledge the NIH and the CDC, who have been invaluable in moving this field forward, NSF, James S. McDonald Foundation, and other public agencies for supporting the work. And I want to acknowledge the long list of collaborators, students, postdocs, who've been involved in the studies that I shared with you tonight. So thank you very much. Should I just go ahead and take questions myself?
Yeah. Would you say something about the elderly?
The elderly are great. No. So for seasonal influenza, the vast majority of mortality from seasonal influenza is in people who are over age 65. So there are other high-risk groups, kids under age 5, people who are immunocompromised, pregnant women, people who have chronic pulmonary and cardiac disease. And there are other high-risk groups, but the elderly really are, you know, among the most at risk, and they are the most likely to end up in a hospital or even die from our annual epidemics. For pandemic influenza, the patterns are a little bit unpredictable. It depends on the particular virus that ends up causing the pandemic. So in 2009, it turned out there were sort of older adults, sort of age brackets, that were less susceptible to that virus than younger people because they had been exposed in their childhood to the virus that was circulating at the time that happened to be more similar to that H1N1 virus than the virus that had been circulating in the childhoods of people of other ages. So with a pandemic, the relative case fatality rate, the relative risk as a function of age, will depend on what that virus looks like relative to the viruses that, or we think, relative to the viruses that first affected you when you were a child.
Sorry. And speaking of the seasonal aspects of transmission, when the data that you showed reflected North American school year and our seasonal calendar in North America, what's going on in the Southern Hemisphere? Is it the same, or is the ebb and flow of people around the world sufficient that it sort of cancels out the seasonal aspects?
Yeah. That's a very good question. So I really, without saying it, I've really been focusing on the U.S. and the things that I've been describing really only pertain to the Northern Hemisphere. So what's going on the rest of the globe with influenza? Well, the Southern Hemisphere is kind of the mirror image. Their flu season is in their winter, which is our summer, and it sort of looks like ours, but just at the opposite time of year. So And in the tropics and subtropics, influenza doesn't have kind of very predictable seasonality the way it does in the northern and the summer southern hemisphere. So that last study that I talked about with predicting what time of year is the pandemic going to emerge, that's predicting it assuming it's going to happen in the northern hemisphere. And we might have the exact opposite prediction if it was emerging out of the southern hemisphere. That said, all of the pandemics on recent record did emerge out of the northern hemisphere, not out of the southern hemisphere. So why is that? I mean, we have hypotheses we don't really know. It might be just because population densities are higher. There's just simply more people living in higher concentration in the northern hemisphere than in the southern hemisphere. Most of these pandemics have emerged not directly from wild animals into humans, but from domesticated animals into humans. And there's much more farming, much more agriculture, animal agriculture in the northern hemisphere than in the southern hemisphere, you know, particularly these very high-density poultry farms and swine farms. So it may just be that we have the right kind of sociological and agricultural conditions for flu emergence, or better conditions for flu emergence in the northern hemisphere than the southern hemisphere.
Yeah, speaking about the southern hemisphere, I know that the strains circulating that previous winter are kind of helped to make the decision about what to put in the flu vaccine for the northern hemisphere. I was interested in your slide about growth rate and variance and growth rate. Is that being used at all when you take the southern hemisphere virus isolates and look at their growth rate and the variance in the growth rate between them in order to help make the decision about what to use in the vaccine?
Yeah. Okay, that's a very good question. As you know, are they using these more sophisticated models and trying to project growth rates when they're making the decision about which specific viruses to include in the vaccine for next year? And I mean, the short answer is I don't actually know what the people sitting at that table are doing and what they're looking at. But I do know that they are collecting data on viruses from all over the world, northern hemisphere, southern hemisphere tropics. I do know that there are some excellent modelers that are giving advice on, you know, how to do the best you can with the surveillance data you have. And, you know, I am sure that they're not just saying what is the most prevalent flu virus and putting that in the vaccine. They are looking at trajectories. So if they see that there is a trajectory where there is maybe a low frequency virus that is very quickly increasing in virus, that would be a good candidate for a flu vaccine.
You explained to us how we could achieve herd immunity by protecting the entire population, about 95%. The World Health Organization said the U.S. might lose its designation as a country that has eliminated measles. My question is, where does vaccine hesitancy fit into all this? The anti-vaccine groups that have come up, they don't trust the science. And you know, the issue of autism. We know that most people are notoriously awful at assessing their own risk, especially in medical decision making. How does that fit into your model?
Yeah, well, that's a very good question, and we talked about this a little bit last night. But how does vaccine hesitancy? How does this what some might say irrational and unsubstantiated fear of vaccines that's leading people not to vaccinate their children against childhood diseases? How does that relate to all of this? And You know, for measles, it is a serious problem, and it's a serious public health crisis in the United States, and it's one of these ones where the disparity is sort of flipped over. Usually, it's the at-risk communities that don't have access to health care, that are poorer, more socioeconomically disadvantaged, that are also disadvantaged from the perspective of public health. But in this case, it happens to be among the most affluent, among the most educated, among the whitest populations that are keep not vaccinating their kids and increasing the risk of measles outbreaks. But what about for flu? So I think I mentioned this earlier. About in a typical year, like last year, about 45% of people living in the US opted to vaccinate for flu, right? It's not mandatory, but it's encouraged. So, whereas for measles, you gotta vaccinate over 95% of a population to prevent or eradicate measles. For flu, you can make a bigger dent with a lower proportion vaccinated. So, you know, certainly 45% is not, you know, if you have a 45% vaccinating with an efficacy of 28%, you're not actually achieving that much of a herd effect. But, you know, the question is, if you have a pandemic, if you have something where you really, like, it will make the difference if people vaccinate or not, the decision-making, people's behavior might look a little bit different than the decision they're making about their children with measles, right? That that is going to be a situation where there is a lot of fear, a lot of kind of instinct for self-preservation. And like, you know, with measles, the people who are deciding not to vaccinate their children, they probably never experienced measles in their lifetime, right? They don't have any direct experience. They don't know how horrible it can be. They don't understand why it was such a life-saving innovation. If we have a disease where people are dying, you know, next door, I think people will have a different decision process. This is just my guess. Now, you know, I'm not a psychologist, but my guess is that you would probably see a higher uptake.
Okay, we have one last question over here.
So the last question got at part of what I was going to ask, but if you look at your most up-to-date model, the best model you have now, and if you look at perturbations of that model, for example, to get to the last question, if everybody was vaccinated, would that be a huge perturbation in the pandemic incidence, the death rate? If you could reduce the time of vaccine production from 6 months to 5 months, would that have a huge rate? And what would have the biggest impact, if you look at your model, what would have the biggest impact on the outcome? And how would the antiviral drugs, the ones we've had, Tamiflu and so on, and the new antivirals fit into that model? Would that have a big impact?
Okay, so the question is, which parameters in our model are going to have, if we change them a little bit, are going to have the biggest impact on the fate of the pandemic? And that's a very difficult question to answer. It depends on how much you're changing the parameters. And, you know, we have parameters that govern how the flu spreads and how virulent it is. You know, so if the death rate changes a little bit, you might have just as much infection, but fewer people dying from it. So there are many different parameters that fundamentally impact how flu spreads, any one of which, if you change it a little bit. And I can't remember if it was you, but it was someone who was sitting on this side of the room. No, it wasn't you, but it was someone who was sitting over there yesterday who asked about asymptomatic infection. And I mean, this is something that none of these models really capture well, but if we have a large proportion of people who are not showing up on those flu curves, who are actually getting infected without symptoms or not going to the doctor, that are actually spreading disease, that is an oversight that could really change, you know, the outcomes of the models. Let me get, so the answer to the first part is everything matters. The second part, though, is what specifically, how will these antivirals, at least what do our models say about the impact of these antivirals? And for Tamiflu, our models tell us that even if we, you know, have hundreds of millions of courses of antivirals and we get them to people right away, it may save lives because it'll, you know, reduce the severity of illness, but probably even with tons of Tamiflu, it won't have a big impact on the overall incidence, the overall transmission dynamics. If a person takes their first dose of Tamiflu, like say within 24, 48 hours, it's really not gonna shorten their window of infectiousness by all that much. Now, you can also use Tamiflu prophylactically. So if somebody gets infected and there's a household member who's at high risk, maybe because they're an asthmatic or they're older, they're immunocompromised, if you give that person Tamiflu prophylactically, they will be protected or at least partially protected against severe infection for the entire duration that they're actually taking the drug, but not beyond the time they're taking the drug. So that can, if there is enough for everybody to take it prophylactically, that could have an impact on the transmission dynamics. With this new drug, Baloxavir, it's a little bit early to say, but the early clinical trials show a much more dramatic drop in viral load, so how much virus is actually in the blood of people who take the drug. And infectiousness is a function of viral load. So this new drug maybe could make a little bit more of a dent on the transmission dynamics if it really is administered very early after people have symptoms. And hopefully there will be other antivirals, you know, developed in the near future that could have an even bigger impact.
Okay, well, thank you very much to Lauren for those two fantastic lectures. Thank you all for coming. I'd also like to remind you all to join us here again on October 22nd for SFI Professor Jessica Fleck and her lecture. She's also the chair of these public events.
Thank you.